glad to welcome you this morning to First Baptist Church here in Clay Center, Kansas. Do you know this is the first Sunday of spring? Oh, I think it was 40-something when Barbara called the weather, but that's okay. We'll take it. We are glad that you're here. I want to very quickly, before we have our call to worship, which is, Lord, I lift up your name on high, I want to recognize Alea. Where is she at? She's in the nursery. Tomorrow is her fourth birthday. So if you see Alea, make sure to say happy birthday to her. And then on the 30th is Amy Sutton's birthday, and she does not turn four. So we congratulate her on that. Tomorrow is Karen Yarrow's birthday. They are away. And then later in the week is also Karen and Lee's anniversary. So we celebrate that. And Nancy Lee told me not to recognize or make a big deal out of her anniversary. So this is not a big deal, but we congratulate Nancy and Jean Lee on their anniversary as well. And so after all that, will you stand now as we begin our service singing, Lord, I lift your name on high. And this song kind of has a long introduction. That you would speak to our hearts, that you would help us to be the people you want us to be for your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated as we welcome our worship leader, Jacob Cutchell.
Sunday School Breakfast, March 31st, 9:15. Bob Stratton from Common Ground Ministries is going to come by and give us a rundown of what exactly they do. And I would imagine there's probably just going to be some kind of sign up to help with Common Ground. Or is he just giving a speech on Common Ground? Okay. Well, I know they're always looking for volunteers and whatnot, so. Meals on Wheels, we have an opportunity to serve in our community by delivering Meals on Wheels in April. If you'd like to help with this service, please call Karen Yarrow. I've done Meals on Wheels before. it's a great service. The only thing you really need to have is a phone with some GPS, because there's a lot of different houses all over town, and I got lost. So, Simply Blessed is Ladies Spring Fling here in the Fellowship Hall, Tuesday, April 9th at 6 p.m. $6 donation requested. You can sign up or RSVP in the office. Noah is the Senior Saints trip. Senior Citizen. Okay, well, I just want to make sure. Special movie presentation in Topeka, Kansas, Thursday, April 11th at 2:30. They depart for Topeka, at 12:30 in the afternoon, not at night. Return around 6 p.m. in the evening. Tickets are $14, and you sign up outside the office. The Young Married Small Group is going to start back on April 14th at 9:15, and they'll meet every second and fourth Sunday of each month. And we're going to go over, it's a study called The Art of Marriage. All couples are welcome, so not just young married couples. I mean, any couples are welcome. But there are books that go along with this course, so if you want to join in on the study, you'll have to get with Michelle Gillard. That way she can make sure we have enough books for everyone to participate. One thing about it, if you're a visitor, you have a prayer request, if you wouldn't mind tearing off the edge of the bulletin and putting it in the offering plate so that we have record of your attendance and prayer requests. Well, I was kind of struggling with what I was going to bring up this morning, and I hope I don't step on the pastor's toes, because I know we're going over the, Jesus being crucified and everything. So I kind of skipped ahead in a little bit, but, you know, too often our words are very, very important. You know, I don't know how many of us have gotten a text message or an email from somebody and got to thinking, you know, what in the world are they talking about? This is completely, you know, not something, I just don't understand what they're talking about. Well, our words are very important. Sometimes we get in a hurry and, you know, we just write things down and without giving them full thought. So this kind of reminded me of those kind of things. This is John 19. So this is where Pilate had Jesus crucified. So Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." So once again, our words are very important. We need to choose our words very carefully in text messages, emails, and whatever, that everything has meaning, just like it was wrote here. Pilate understood the meaning of the words and started to understand that Jesus was the King of the Jews and would not change his words because of that. So if everybody would now stand up and give a right hand of fellowship, and we'll greet each other.
Morning.
So energetic this morning and willing to share. It's nice. I could have the ushers come forward. Oh, Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you for the many blessings that you have bestowed upon us. And we ask that you please take these tithes and use them to the furtherance of your kingdom. And we just give you all praise, honor, and glory. We say these things in your Son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now, if you'll stand and join me as we sing our hymn of praise. No, I'm not Jerry Mayo. He and his wife are away this weekend. So we'll be singing hymn 494, which is It Took a Miracle, verses 1, 2, and 3. Yeah. the Lord in prayer. Father God, again we thank you for the opportunity to assemble together this morning. We thank you for each one that is here, each family, each individual, Lord. We thank you, God, that you promise to be in our midst as we gather together, two or three, in your name. And Lord, we do that this day. We desire to draw all attention to you, to give our focus wholly to you, our whole heart. And Lord, we lift to you those that are dealing with difficulties. Father, we continue to pray for Lee Campbell and ask that your hand would be upon her, that you'd give her strength and encouragement. We thank you for the positive steps that she has taken as she recovers from this situation, Lord. We lift to you also our friend Arlene as she's recovering from her surgery this past week. We thank you that things went well and that she is doing well as well. We continue to pray for those that are traveling. We think of Lee and Karen that are gone, Delmer and Sharon that are gone, and others as well, Jerry and Cindy. And we ask, Lord, that your hand would be upon them, that you give them strength and encouragement. And Father, we know that each one of us, as we come together, we carry with us concerns. We carry with us frustrations, perhaps. We carry with us things that we don't know the solution or answer for, but we know you, God. And Father, we humble ourselves before you this morning, seeking your guidance, seeking your direction in every situation. We list or think of the many others that are on our prayer list this morning, and we lift those to you this morning as well, and pray that we, as we are able, will reach out to them to encourage them as you make that possible, Lord. We again thank you and praise you for the many ways that you work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated at this time. Elementary class, Sunday school class members, there's just a couple of them here today, are going to come and we're going to sing a song for you. You know, this is, oh, yes. All right, I was going to say this reminds me so much of my Sunday school lesson for just a moment, because my Sunday school lesson was called No Boys Allowed, and so I was going to be three, but Lucas was very brave. All right, I think he would rather stand here, so I'll take what I can get. And our song for today is Wise Man, Foolish Man. All right, and here, maybe, can I switch to this one, Jeff? How about before we do this, you give them some encouragement? The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock. The wise man built his house upon the rock, and the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up. And the house on the rock stood firm. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. The foolish man built his house upon the sand. And the rains came tumbling down. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up. The rains came down and the floods came up, and the house on the sand went splat. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ, and the blessings will come down. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. So build your house on. And you know exactly what I'm going to say. I want you to sing it with us, and you've seen the motions. So are you ready?
So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ. So build your house on the Lord Jesus Christ, and the blessings will come down. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. The blessings will come down as the prayers go up. So build your house on the Lord.
Yeah! All right. I was going to say now as the choir comes down to join you, but the choir's not up here this morning. At this point, the youth and children may be dismissed for children's church. And as they're going, I want to remind the youth that this evening we've made a change to our regular youth program. We're going to be going at 2 p.m. to the Rex Theater here in town to see a faith-based movie. And so the youth fund will cover the cost of the tickets. And I know some other people from First Baptist are also planning to go see it this afternoon. It's Tim Tebow, the Christian athlete, helped produce the film. And it's supposed to be a movie that encourages people to turn to God. And so we thought, well, we want to make sure that they carry movies like that here in Clay Center. So we're going to be seeing that. So if you have nothing to do at 2 p.m. this afternoon, I know it's prime nap time, but if you've got nothing to do then, we invite you to join us as well. But at this time, before we do our scripture reading, we have a mission announcement, I guess we would call it, and I think we're all set up, right? So let's give our attention to that.
Hi everyone, it's Laura and I here, and we just wanted to share with you a little life update and what's been happening to us recently.
Yep. So Jared and I are currently living in Mission, Kansas. We've been here for a little less than a year now. I am currently teaching third grade with the Shawnee Mission School District at Neiman Elementary. I've been doing that since last January, and I am really enjoying it.
Yep, and I am finishing up my senior year at Midwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. Intentions to graduate in May with my degree in intercultural studies.
Yep. So the main thing we wanted to really share with you guys has to do with our heart for missions. Since before Jared and I even got married, God kind of like laid missions on our hearts individually, which was kind of exciting. Then when we got married, that it was something that we got to continue pursuing and exploring together. And particularly cross-cultural overseas missions is something that Jared and I have always been really interested in.
Yeah, so along with that, last summer we got to actually take a trip to South Sudan in Africa. We got to visit a friend of mine. He's also a former youth leader. His name is Justin Cole. He has a wife, Amy, two sons, Ezekiel and Caleb. And it was an opportunity just for us to visit and hang out with them, but also to bring some supplies and gifts from friends and family back in the States. But also an opportunity for Laura and I to see if this could possibly be an opportunity for missions in the future, like would we want to team up with them?
Yeah, so while we were there, we really got to experience what their daily life is like, living in a tribal culture. We got to see how do they disciple local believers, learn the language, how are they encouraging and building up the local church to be a multiplying church. And we got to learn a lot about their long-term vision for multiplying the church, reaching other villages and other tribes in the area. And then also learning about their needs as a team and whether or not we'd be a good fit for that.
So after learning all these things and experiencing a little bit ourselves, we've been praying about it. We've decided to join their team and continue this journey. So ever since we got back to the States, we've been taking steps to continue that process.
So last fall, we submitted our initial application to Pioneers. Pioneers is the sending agency that Justin and Amy are with. And so since then, we've been invited by Pioneers to visit their headquarters in Florida to really explore whether or not we're a good fit for Pioneers, whether or not Pioneers is a good fit for us, and to see if we can keep moving forward on joining their team. So we'll be going to Florida the first full week of May, and we'll know by the end of that week whether or not we've been accepted to continue pursuing joining their team.
Yeah, so if we are accepted, we will be taking steps then to support Raise for our launch date. Launch date is obviously going to be in God's timing, but we are expecting about 2 years to be fully supported and funded and ready to go with any other little details worked out.
So in the next couple of years, there's going to be a lot of big life changes as we continue pursuing joining this team in Africa, and especially since we won't be traveling alone. We will have a new adventurer joining our team.
That's right. We are expecting baby Tef to be joining us September 8th. So we're finally excited to announce that and share that with friends and family. But yeah, just continue to keep us in your prayers as we continue to take these next steps towards South Sudan and pursuing this journey.
And growing our family.
Yeah, and growing our family. Thanks for listening, everyone.
We love you all. Bye.
I had the opportunity to see that, was it Saturday? Friday. And make sure that you pat Jeff and Linda on the back and get really excited for them and with them, and Bernadelle and Larry. Jeff said that I wasn't as excited as he thought I would be. He actually said, did you watch the whole thing through? It's not my grandbaby. No. But we congratulate them. Do keep them in your prayers. You know, I was sitting there thinking, contemplating and following the Lord to a mission field is one thing. Following the Lord to the mission field with a 2-year-old. We need to be praying, folks. So keep Jared and Laura Beth in your prayers and the whole family. And so that is a great announcement. It's an exciting announcement. To recognize, and it's always exciting for a church when somebody that they've seen grow up follows the Lord in missions. And so I don't know if I'll be visiting that mission field in Africa. I know we get mileage reimbursement, but that's a little... Anyways. All right, so go ahead and if you will, turn in your Bibles. We'll have our scripture reading. We've been looking at Pilate and his interaction with Jesus. Our scripture passage for this morning is from John chapter 19. We had been looking at John chapter 18, but now we've jumped to chapter 19. And if you'll stand, we'll read from John chapter 19. I'm going to read verses 6 to 10 to give us the context here. John chapter 19, verse 6 to 10. Therefore, when the chief priests and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "You take him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to our law, he ought to die because he made himself the Son of God." Therefore, when Pilate heard that saying, he was the more afraid, and went again into the praetorium and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Are you not speaking to me? Do you not know I have power to crucify you and power to release you?" Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you so much for the opportunity to look at your word. Lord, we do pray, Lord, that you would speak to our hearts and help us to learn what you want us to learn, to apply it in our lives for your glory and our benefit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. You know, as we move closer and closer to Easter, it's only 1 month away, less than a month now. You know, it's an exciting time. You know, it's always an exciting time. It's the day that we set aside to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But we know as believers in Jesus, every day we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. But we have progressed through several of the questions that Pilate has asked over the last several weeks. You'll remember that the Jewish leadership, the high priests, were angered by Jesus and the prominence that he had attained. They didn't believe that Jesus was the Messiah, the promised one, the one that they had waited for so long as a people. You know, they had waited and waited and waited for centuries. And that's one of the great tragedies in this, that for so long they looked for him, and when he showed up, they said, "No, we don't want this one." You know, and because they didn't accept him, and his claims to be the Messiah, he was viewed as being blasphemous. And let's be honest, if what he's saying wasn't true, he was speaking blasphemy. Pilate asks a few questions, and again we remember that he asked them, the way that he asked them kind of gives us the idea that he had some answers in mind already. We've talked about this when he asked them first, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And obviously he thought the answer was no, because there were no followers, right? And because the Jews, who he was supposed to be king of, had turned him over to Pilate. You know? The second question, again, he kind of figured there was going to be an answer. He says, "Well, what have you done?" Well, the Jews said if Jesus were not an evildoer, they wouldn't have handed him over. You know? So Pilate again assumes that Jesus must be guilty of something. But after their conversation, Pilate begins to rethink the situation as we look at it. As he has this opportunity to talk to Jesus, things begin to change, and he repeats himself. He says, "Are you a king then?" It's almost an exact repeat of the first question. And then finally, in response to Jesus' words, Pilate asks, "What is truth?" And that's the question we considered last week. And after asking that question, Pilate, almost immediately walks out and makes a public declaration of the truth. He says, "I find no fault in him at all." And you may remember that word "no." Do you remember that from last week? That was the most powerful "no" that they could use. You know, not like a mom and dad when the kid says, "Can I have an extra cookie?" You say no. But the kid knows if they push and push and push, maybe they'll get another cookie. This is a capital N, a capital O, and several exclamation points afterward. This is when mom says no at the Coleman house. You know, when dad says no, it's a debatable thing. But when mom says no, it's done. Now, you know, some assume that Pilate is just cynical, he's being political and just going through the motions, but his decision was not a decision that would score him political points. You know, if you think about him going out and saying, "I don't find any fault in this guy at all." You know, they say, "Well, he was just a politician doing what politicians do." No, that was not what a smart politician, not what a savvy politician. You know, now we know in America we got all kinds of politicians. Very few are smart and savvy. But, you know, that's not what a savvy political person would do. His decision was not one that was going to bring rest or quiet to the religious tensions that existed either. You know, there was tension, there was turmoil, there was strife in that community because the Jews didn't like what was going on. The Jews didn't like the message that Jesus was presenting. And so, you know, for Pilate to go, "Well, I don't find any fault in him," well, that wouldn't quiet that down. That's only going to ratchet it up more. And it wouldn't make him popular. You know, we all like to be popular, don't we? Jacob, don't you like to be popular? No? Well, good, because you're not. No, just kidding. We like to be popular, you know. And some of us, you know, we say, well, I'm not willing to compromise certain things for popularity, but we like to be known and well-liked, right? As human beings. So for a supposed cynic that was truly in opposition to Jesus, because that's what some people will say, he takes the most supportive position of Jesus possible. And in the intervening passage between what we looked at last week, the end of chapter 18 and the beginning of chapter 19, Pilate even goes further. He has this discussion with Jesus, and then he goes, you remember, Pilate offers Jesus as the logical choice to benefit from their tradition of releasing a prisoner before Passover. You know. So Pilate makes a move from being a more passive investigator, you know, interrogating Jesus. He goes from being more passive, assuming that the claims against Jesus are true, and here, at the end of chapter 18, he's an active proponent, making an argument for Jesus' release and innocence. At the end of chapter 18, the people cry out, not for Jesus, but for Barabbas. Chapter 19 begins with Pilate, a man who was seemed to be kind of vacillating, maybe a little bit wishy-washy, maybe a flip-flopper, and you know, we don't like that. It's hard to know where you stand with somebody that's wishy-washy. If right now they say one thing and in 5 minutes they're going to say another thing. You know, I was watching the news this week, and already there's one candidate for president on the Democratic side that in her home state they're saying just give it up. And the reason why they want her to give it up, they said, well, you know, you used to believe this, and now you believe this. And they said, well, that shows us that you're a follower, not a leader, because we don't know what position you're going to take. And so we don't like people that are leaders that you don't know what position they hold. You know, because there's no trust in that. You know, how do we know? You know, if I say, well, I promise I'm not going to raise your taxes, vote for me for president, and then the first thing I do is raise your taxes, they say, oh, but what if I said, Larry, I'm not going to raise your taxes. Bernadelle, I am going to raise your taxes. Martha, I'm not, I might raise your taxes. You go, how? You know? So we don't like wishy-washy people. We don't like vacillating people. Now, are there situations where, you know, we become more aware of things or more educated in things that our opinions may change? Absolutely. But you know what? Sometimes in election cycles, those things change almost every different audience that they have. But here we have this politician, and he was kind of vacillating. At first he thought one thing, and then as he went through, we see something else. But one of the interesting things about it is many commentators look at Pilate's action in this situation, and they suggest that his actions are not based on Pilate's conclusions or his beliefs, but rather they are based on what one Bible scholar calls the fixed malignity of the rulers. The fixed malignity of the rulers. That means the rulers didn't like Jesus. Another commentary suggests that the motivations of Pilate were not because of Pilate's belief that Jesus was guilty, but was an attempt to appease the Jews. And how sad is this? This is one of those sad things about Pilate, because we see almost an idea of a compromise. That he knew, but made this choice. And as we go through, we can get a better understanding of Pilate. Verse 4 of John 19, we read, Pilate then went out again and said to them, Behold, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no fault in him. He does reaffirm his original conclusion. And traditionally, we look at that passage and we see, well, you know, Pilate allowed Jesus to be scourged, and Pilate allowed Jesus to be crucified. But when we take a step back, we see in chapter 18, Pilate said, I find no fault in him. And in chapter 19, he says, I find no fault in him. And after this, Pilate takes Jesus back into the praetorium, back where they can have a private conversation, back where there's not all the listening ears. And now we come to this fifth question that Pilate asks, and it seems almost like a strange question as we just read it. He asks, where are you from? You know, and it is strange, where are you from? Because we read it and we think of it as a question of vital statistics, you know. If I ask, where are you from? We think, well, where were you born? Or we might think, well, where do you live? Right? Our mind goes to really a question of residence, you know. If I say, Patricia Talbot, where are you from? Clay Center. Patricia, where were you born? Omaha. Oh, that explains it all. You know, so that's, you know, we think about it. If we just think, read those words and just think initially about that sentence, that question, that's what we think of. But we take a step back and we need to think about it a little bit more deeply, because Pilate has moved from asking a question with an assumed or presumed answer. You know. But now he's asking, and he really wants to know. I think he may suspect something. But in his word, where are you from? His question. That word where, it's a very familiar word for us, and it's often associated again with a relationship to a place, specifically being at or in or to a place. You know, we think about that. But biblically, and what are we studying? The Bible. Biblically, this word where, in that form, appears 29 times in the New Testament. 29. Right? Hey, same as Amy's age. Amy Sutton turns 29 the end of the week right now. But it's used to describe more than just a relationship to places. All right? And while, yes, this word does refer and speak about location, it also speaks about a relation to condition or a source, as in someone or something authoring or giving something. It speaks of parentage, and it speaks of cause. So Pilate, in his question, where are you from? Pilate's not just asking this question, or a question. He is asking the question. He's not asking about Jesus being a Galilean. He's not saying, hey, were you born in Bethlehem? I heard that you were born in Bethlehem. I got a cousin that lives in Bethlehem over on First Street. That's not what he's asking. Pilate knew that. It is a question about his nature. It is a question about, are you a mere man or are you divine? It's a question not about his mission, but about his personal origin. Pilate is really asking, are you the Son of God? Are you the Son of God? And what is most fascinating about this question is Jesus' response. You know, if we recall, as Pilate and Jesus had their conversation, Pilate would ask something and Jesus would say something. Sometimes it would be another question, you know. And now Pilate has got to the question. And if we were writing this, if I was writing the, you know, if it was the gospel according to Matthew Coleman, not just the gospel according to Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew. You know, I would be, all right, this is when I would write, you know, he says that, and I would say, yes, I am the Son of God, is what Jesus said. But Jesus does not respond. Jesus does not reply. Jesus does not affirm anything when Pilate asks. And we think, well, why not? Well, of course, part of that is because of prophecy, you know, like a lamb, you know. And so he was silent. So part of it is that prophecy and fulfilling that. And the truth of the matter, really, I think, partly as well, is that Jesus didn't need to respond. It's almost like, if you ever, as a parent or a grandparent or somebody watching kids, and you, something happens, maybe something gets broken or something, and you say, hey, Bev, did you do that? And Bev doesn't really need to answer with words. You can tell in her eyes or her demeanor, right? I should have picked Yvonne. But Bev was right in between Yvonne and Barb, or Barb, Bob. Well, Barb's over there. But Bev is right there. But you know, you ever see a kid and you're like, oh, they don't even have to confess it. They don't have to speak the words. You can see it in their body language. You can see it in their expression, in their words, or in their attitude. And as we think about this, as we think about the history of Pilate and his possible conversation, we can really get a sense that Pilate must have, or likely did, figure it out. And if we look at this passage, and we look at what we look at next week, like what Jacob read this morning, I'm glad he read that, because we're not talking about that until next week, but it helps us to really understand that, because ultimately, what did Pilate write? What did he have written? He's the king of the Jews. He didn't say this man was found guilty of claiming to be the king. He said, he put a sign up there that says, this guy's the king. This guy's the one. Now again, if you stop and take a step back and you say, how crazy could Pilate be? That's only going to stir things up. That's only going to make people mad. But Pilate knew it's the truth. Now, I know we live in a world where we don't value truth anymore. We value how people feel more than what the truth is. And not that I think we need to go around smacking each other just because we want them to feel bad. But when we take steps away from the truth, you think, well, how hard can it be? No. If you don't have a common foundation, a common place at which we all start, a common truth, then you can really have no commonality. You know, I love when they say, well, I want them to speak their truth. Well, truth is truth. It's not my truth or your truth. You may not like my truth, but truth is truth. Or I should say, you may not like the truth, because it just said there's no my truth or your truth, and contradicted myself. Joyce caught it, but that's okay. Pilate has got to the question. And again, as we think about that, it is just fascinating. It's fascinating because, again, we remember the things we've learned about Pilate and looking back over history and see how this really does change the way we read the Bible. It changes the way we look at the character of Pilate. This morning, as we consider the Word of God, we look at this passage where Pilate asks what otherwise is a pretty simple and straightforward question. But we look at it and we see that Pilate is asking again, are you the Son of God? Are you from God? That's what, you know, sometimes we say that, where are you from? You know, we aren't really asking, you know, a location, but we're kind of like, you're different. You're a little bit different. You know? Yeah. And that's kind of what he was asking. Are you divine? And you know, some people say, Jesus never claimed to be the Son of God. Well, that simply doesn't agree with what the Bible teaches. In John chapter 5, verse 18, it says, therefore the Jews sought all the more to kill him, because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Well, that's pretty straightforward to me, but in Exodus 3:14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he says, thou shalt say to the children of Israel, I am, has sent me to you. Later in John chapter 8, verse 58, Jesus said to them, most assuredly I say to you, before Abraham was, I am. They knew exactly what Jesus was saying. In John chapter 10, verse 30, I and my Father are one. Then the Jews took up stones again to stone him. Jesus answered them, many good works I have shown you from my Father. For which of those works do you stone me? The Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we do not stone you, but for blasphemy, because you, being a man, make yourself God. So for those people that say, Jesus never claimed to be God, Jesus never claimed to be a Son of God, it simply isn't true. And for those people that say, well, Jesus was a nice guy, he was a good teacher, well, he can't be. It's one of those things, that old thing, he's either a liar, a lunatic, or the Lord, right? Remember that? Because he says, I'm God, and if he's not God, well, we ought to look at him and say, what a scandal, what a scoundrel. He lied to all of humanity. But he didn't. He is who he said he is. And tonight's Bible study, a little plug for it, at 5 p.m., we're going to look a little bit more at Jesus' claim about this. Look at the Bible about that a little bit more. But the religious leaders of the time, they clearly understood Jesus as claiming to be the Son of God. That's why they wanted to put him to death. His disciples clearly understood Jesus to be claiming to be the Son of God. And this morning we can see Pilate is figuring out that Jesus is claiming to be the Son of God. As we conclude this morning, there's just really one more thing to find out. As we said, we know where the religious leaders stood. We know where the disciples stood. The religious leaders heard it and rejected it. The disciples heard it, and most of them accepted it. Pilate, again, based on the historical and archaeological evidence that exists, also seems to have believed it. And while that's fascinating, their views and their decisions, you know, we could talk about it. But those aren't really what are important right now, are they? What's important is your decision. Your view. What do you think about Jesus Christ? Where do you think Jesus Christ is from? Is he just from that little manger in Bethlehem? Well, yes, he was born there, but that's not where he's from. Have you come to a place where you have asked Jesus in your heart, where are you from? That you've asked him, are you really the Son of God? And have you accepted the truth? Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God? That is the message for today. That is the message for every day. Do you believe that Jesus left heaven in its glory, lived a perfect, sinless life in order to bridge the gap that exists between us and God, in order to restore our relationship with our Creator and our Father? If you've made that decision already, we say, praise the Lord. We celebrate. If you've not made that choice, make that choice today. The Bible tells us that Jesus is a way, a truth, a life. Is that what it says?
No.
No?
The
way. The truth. The life. The Bible tells us in Acts 4, there is a couple other names under heaven given? No. There is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. And we know that the Bible tells us in John 3 that whoever believes in Jesus shall have everlasting life. That's the message for us. You know, it's exciting to look at Pilate and to consider what he went through, to consider the struggles, to consider the choices that he made. But as we look at this passage, and as we look at history, and as we look at archaeology, and as we go back and look and say, this is what Pilate says. Pilate says, I don't find any fault in him. He says it again. And then he pushed a sign up when Jesus is crucified, saying, this is the King of the Jews. You know, and we put our Pilate hat on, and we think about what he must be thinking. As we go through next week, as we continue and conclude this sermon series, if we just stop and think about it, you know, we think of Pilate as a villain, but now let's imagine that Pilate really did know who Jesus was, and now is being used by God to accomplish God's purpose for our salvation, and sitting there going, come on, Jesus, come on, Jesus. Come on, Jesus. He says, don't you know I have the power? We're going to talk about this. I have the power to crucify you or not. Come on! But Jesus knew God had a plan. And so for us as human beings to sit back and go, wait a second. This isn't going the way that I want it to go. This isn't the way I would have it go. Jesus, come on, do something about this. It totally changes the way we look at Pilate. Was Pilate perfect? No. If we have a passion play, are you going to want to play Pilate? No, because no one wants to. But as we look at Scripture, as we look back and say, well, wait a second, if this guy really did think Jesus was who he said he was, and he sees his hands being tied, because Jesus what? Silence. Jesus doesn't defend himself. Why? Because Jesus can't defend himself. Yes, he could. Was he guilty? No, he was not guilty. But if Jesus gets himself off the hook, if Jesus doesn't go to the cross, if Jesus doesn't pay the price, where are we? We're lost. We're in trouble. We have no hope. But Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. And the fascinating thing is, what if Pilate knew exactly what Jesus was doing too? But the real question is, do you know what Jesus did for you? As we invite Jim to come and prepare to sing our hymn of worship, let's stand as we have our hymn of invitation. Let's stand as we have our time of invitation. Father God, we do thank you so much for the opportunity to look at your word, to consider it. And Father, we often fill in the blanks in the Bible as we read different narratives and try to understand it and think, what would we do? And Lord, we know for so often Pilate, you know, has been looked down upon. And there are things that, you know, we think we would do different. But would we? And while those questions are fascinating, we can debate them, Lord. The most important thing is, have we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord, our Savior? Have we recognized where Jesus came from? That He came from heaven. That He is our Creator. He is our Sustainer. He is the beginning and the end, the author and finisher. He is the Messiah. He is the Anointed One. He is the Christ. We pray that each one that is here this morning has made that choice. And if there's any that haven't, we ask, Lord, that Your Holy Spirit would speak to their heart, that they would make that choice today for Your glory, for their benefit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's have our hymn of invitation.
Heaven Came Down, hymn number 510, if you want to join in the hymnal. If you'd like to come forward and share any change in your life of how God has worked and come down to be with you today, you'd come and join Pastor this morning.
Sunday evening Bible study, and then there will not be the normally scheduled 6 p.m. youth meeting, because I can only do so much in one day. But let's be dismissed with prayer. Father God, again, we thank You for the opportunity to assemble together. We ask that You go with us as we leave this place, and Lord, we do help, or do ask that You would allow us to have opportunity to share the truth of who Jesus is in our life with somebody else. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Kobe out.
Oh. Somebody's getting in a hurry down there.
No, her grandpa was Jefferson. Oh, okay. So he actually won.
Right, I saw that. So
they just ran down quick for it and came back the next day.
Okay. Your grandma's birthday was
it is. Yeah. And then mom's anniversary in my place with Ashley and dad's downstairs. Okay.
Well, I just a
prayer
request like that from your mom. Mm-hmm. Or your grandma. Yeah.
Okay.
Like, you know, like my grandma. And then right away I saw this.
Yep.
So is that the whole Branson
there? It's for Missouri. So okay. Each state does one. Okay. So they had, I think it was 6 nominees.
Okay.
And they thought that the little girl, 11-year-old little girl, had a service project that was really, really good for the grandpa. But that point, there were about 50 people there. So now he goes to the national level of the Jefferson Award. So it's been 2 days in D.C. Okay. Had a bigger award from all the states. I thought they said sometime in May.
Okay.
But I don't remember if they posted it online or not. Mom was telling me.
Yeah,
after, but, awesome. But
yep.
So pretty exciting.
Yeah.